This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised.
There are many things to be said about Rihanna, but one thing that can't be denied is that she is one of the defining pop stars of our generation. In fact, I expect her to clock in as the biggest female pop star of the entire decade, second only to Drake overall. And I've gotta say, I've never been a fan. Like, at all. She does have some good tracks out there, but that's just a demonstration of the law of averages, considering the mind-destroying amount of music this woman has produced in the past 13 years, most of which is disposable schlock meant to fill airtime. However, despite her mediocrity, Rihanna's success does not surprise me at all, because one unequivocally positive trait that I can commend her for is her adaptability. I saw the life inside you. I don't know why or how this works, but Rihanna is able to inflect her vocals in just about any way she wants to, which enables producers to build any type of song they want around her, and likewise to put her into any song that they've built. This is the woman who's able to shift between the poppy and club-friendly This Is What You Came For, the dark and intense Russian Roulette, the loose and bouncy Lemon, and the tired and weary 4 or 5 seconds and have it all sound completely natural. Rihanna is a jack of all trades and a master of none, in the truest sense of the word. But do you know what Rihanna can't sell? Like, at all? I mean, I don't blame her, I guess, because I don't know how anybody is supposed to sell that. But why the hell did she try? Bitch better have my money. Y'all should know me well enough. Bitch better have my money. Play down, call me on my blood. This is the third and final entry in the What the Hell Were You Thinking trilogy, and it is such a definitive example of such that I'm really not sure what to say about it. Like, all you have to do is look at the title and then look at the artist, and you'll immediately see why this song doesn't work. Rihanna seems to have developed this trend in recent years of wanting to be some sort of rugged badass who kicks ass and takes names, but usually she has a good sense of keeping that confined to her music videos, where no one cares besides the screaming fangirls who will validate anything that she does. If my memory serves, this is the only time that Rihanna has actually brought this persona into her music. And it's a good thing, too, because this is just pitiful. Rihanna wants to sound like a seriously intimidating force not to be fucked with, but instead she sounds like a bratty 9-year-old whining that she got her allowance late. Pay me what you want me. Don't act like you forgot. There are plenty of other things that don't work about this song too, but that's the main issue right there. Rihanna is just not an intimidating presence, which is not something that anybody should have to have explained to them. This is the woman who put her career on hold for a year and a half so that she could soundtrack and star in a movie where Sheldon from The Big Bang Theory plays an alien who talks like an Icon Has Cheeseburger cat. She is not a pimp who strips her hostages naked and hangs them upside down in a warehouse. I mean, maybe. Maybe. Maybe this song could have worked if it had a wonky, oppressive, weird beat, kind of like what Needed Me had. Instead, we've got this weak, jingly, pathetic little trap beat so generic that I can't believe 5 people had to work together to make it, 2 of whom were Kanye West and Travis Scott. Bitch Better Have My Money is basically the Gold by Ciara of 2015. A song made by a girl going through her edgy phase where she wears a badass persona like a 50 Cent Halloween store mask that's meant to be intimidating but ends up as nothing but annoying, cringy, and a towering monument to her own insecurity. The only reason this isn't any higher is because A, it's too pathetic to get mad at, and B, I never heard the song on the radio, so it was pretty easy to ignore. The same cannot be said about...
I'm out of control! I take prescriptions to make me feel okay.
I've spent a good portion of 2018 complaining about how bleak and joyless the current pop scene is, and how everybody seems to be drugged up, downbeat, and filled with a whirling vortex of bleak pessimism. But you know what? I will give them this. At least those SoundCloud rappers know how bleak and joyless their music is. If I had to pick one word to describe Dear Future Husband by Meghan Trainor, that word would be gross. The music video is gross, as every shade of pastel is vomited up into a skin-crawlingly artificial parody of reality, which is essentially the 50s as imagined by the 80s as imagined by the 2010s. The production is gross, taking all of the most obnoxiously chipper elements of 50s doo-wop and fusing them together into a loathsome ball of mid-tempo, over-sugared saccharinity. The delivery is gross, as Meghan wears an air of smug superiority as she lectures, not sings, lectures, about the way that marriage is supposed to be. Oh, and on that note, the attitude of this song is gross, as Meghan preaches about the wonders of her marital bliss, completely oblivious to the fact that she's romanticizing one of the most hollow, miserable, and soul-sucking matrimonies ever put to music. And finally, the melody is gross, as it sets this symphony of grossness to one of the most maddeningly catchy tunes of the past few years. And if you still don't realize just how gross this song really is, then please, allow me to count down. This line isn't that bad in a vacuum, but I still put it on here because, according to Meghan, the right way to love somebody is doing what she says in this song. So, fellas, if you don't do all the things that Meghan says in the next four spots, then you are loving incorrectly. Just keep that in mind as we move forward. Even when I'm acting crazy, tell me everything's alright. Oh yes, there's nothing I love more than when somebody is being irrational and crazy and the only way to shut them up is to tell them what they want to hear. It's my favorite! After every fight, just apologize. And maybe then I'll let you try and rock my body right. Even if I was wrong, you know I'm never wrong. Why disagree? Why disagree? Oh, I get it. It's not that you're actually too much of an emotional wreck to think for yourself. It's that rather than taking the time to actually discuss and compromise with your partner, you want to use your body as a carrot on a stick to manipulate him and get whatever you want, because clearly all men are single-minded jack-offs and capable of thinking anything outside of me want to boink lady. Nothing but equal opportunity sexism for good old Meghan here. So, you want to spend more time with me, and your proposed solution to make that happen is to keep me from seeing my family? Okay, not only is that the type of thing that's going to make me want to swap out the engagement ring for a restraining order, but it doesn't even make logical sense. Like, there is no cause and effect there. The first thing does not lead to the second thing. That's like saying, well, oh gee whiz, I sure would love to learn how to make a scrumptious blueberry pie, so to make that happen, I think I'm going to go become a Scientologist, which is frankly something I'd probably choose over marrying Meghan Trainor at this point. I'll be sleeping on the left side of the bed. Hey. Open doors for me and you might get some kisses. Don't have a dirty mind, just be a classy guy. Head. That's what that line is supposed to be. Hold the door for me and you might get some head. And with that, I have now publicly revealed that I have a dirty mind, which means I am not a classy guy and am therefore no longer eligible to marry Meghan Trainor. I know I should be pretty torn up about that, but frankly, right now I think I'm feeling a bit more like Neo from The Matrix when I think about the sheer number of bullets that I just dodged. Look, I'm not one of those people who looks down at a woman if she wants to be a housewife or fill some other traditional gender role. If that's what you want, and that makes you happy, then good for you. Do whatever works. However, this song perfectly illustrates a lot of the reasons why so many people look down on this type of life. And if this song is anything to go by, then I feel bad for whoever Megan's dear future husband ends up being. Yeah, actually, I think she got engaged at the end of last year, if I'm remembering it correctly. Who did she end up with, anyway? Oh, the boy from Spy Kids. How random. Future husband, better love me right. Watch me, watch me, oh, watch me, watch me, oh, watch me, watch me. Some of you guys who have been with me from the very beginning may remember my first ever top 20 ranked video from fall 2017. If you haven't seen it, then you're honestly not missing much. It's one of my first ever videos and it's extremely rough around the edges. One of the more regrettable parts of that video was the part where I talked about my second most hated song at that time, Bodak Yellow by Cardi B. How did I react to it? Well, I promise you that hurt me more than it hurt you. I like to think that I've gained at least some ability to recognize and filter my own cringe since then, but to be totally fair to me, my knee-jerk hatred for Bodak Yellow was at least a little bit understandable. Because, you see, Bodak Yellow reminded me of this other song.
Do you remember when this was a thing? You know, Only by Nicki Minaj and Half a Young Money, also known as one of the worst songs of the current decade.
You knew it was coming. None but real niggas only. Bad bitches only. Rich niggas only. Okay, before we get to the people who actually matter on this track, I got a question for you. What do these songs... Lights it up like it's dynamite. Have in common with this song. Raise every bottle and cup in the sky. Sparks in the air like the 4th of July. If you guessed that they were all produced by the same man, that would be correct. That man being the one, the only, Dr. Luke. Apparently, this was the year that Dr. Luke decided that after producing some of the most upbeat, fun, and infectious tracks of the decade, his time would be better spent making beats so minimal, dour, and unsettling that they would make DJ Mustard blush. After all, you know what else Dr. Luke produced this year? Indeed, Dr. Luke, she does know. And now, so does everybody else. Oh snap! Oh snap! Oh snap! And with that, I have officially used up my one observation about this song that hasn't been beaten into the ground by everybody else already. I mean, there's plenty I could be talking about. I could go on for a bit about how the beat is too weak to sound threatening and too empty to sound cool. I could talk about the Nazi-themed lyric video, that's always a fun one. I could talk about how Drake sounds like a 12-year-old bragging to his friends after he saw a naked lady on the internet for the first time. She was sitting down on that big butt, but I was still staring at the titties, though. I could talk about Nicki adopting an unspectacular and unchallenging flow as she spits out punchlines that are both trying way too hard and not trying at all. My man fool, he just ate. I don't duck nobody but tape. Yeah, that was a setup for a punchline on duct tape. Dinner with my man on a G5 is my idea of an update. These hoes couldn't test me, even if the name was Pop Quiz. Tell them bitches blow me, Lance Stevenson. Freeze every bottle and cup in the sky. I could pretend to hate Chris Brown's hook because he's Chris Brown, even though it's the best part of the song. Just still like being the tallest kid in kindergarten. I could talk about Lil Wayne trying to do Snoop Dogg's Too Cool to Try thing while completely oblivious to the fact that nobody actually liked him at that point. Actually, you know what? That's it. I'm done. I've given this song all the attention it deserves. 3 years later, and this song has already rightfully been forgotten as another relic of the fledgling days of minimalist trap. The only thing keeping it alive in the public conscience are people like me talking about how awful it was, so I'm just gonna stop talking and let the sands of time do their thing. Moving on. You know, regardless of how bad some foods may taste, you can still eat them. It may be a horribly unpleasant experience, but it can still give you some form of nourishment, and you can learn to appreciate the good food even more if the bad food gives you a sense of scale, like a point of comparison. Listening to the rest of the songs on this list, including my number one, is like forcing down some awful, rancid food. Listening to this song is like starving to death. This is my fight song. Take back my life song. You may have heard me say in just about every other video that I've ever made that self-empowerment anthems are my least favorite genre of music, but I feel like that's a bit unfair. You could make a case for songs like Eye of the Tiger being self-empowerment anthems. I don't hate any song whose purpose is to pump you up and make you feel awesome about who you are and what you're doing. However, the difference between the good self-empowerment anthems and my least favorite genre of all time can be boiled down to three simple words. Show, don't, tell. I don't love I Will Survive because Gloria Gaynor just outright says, I am strong and independent and ready to take on the world. I love it because she actually demonstrates through the lyrics that she's strong and independent and ready to take on the world. And she's got the confident delivery and tight locomotive beat to back that sentiment up. If you ask me, the best way to inspire people is to lead by example, to portray your own story of overcoming personal struggles in a way that makes other people want to channel your spirit during their own times of hardship. This is why Under the Bridge by the Chili Peppers, Carry On by Fun, and Lose Yourself by Eminem work as empowerment anthems, while Stronger by Kelly Clarkson, Brave by Sarah Bareilles, and especially Fight Song by Rachel Platten utterly fail. They fail because rather than being inspirational, they're just shouting be inspired over and over again. But even among a sea of flavorless platitudes, Fight Song takes it to the next level by being, no exaggeration, the single most generic song I have ever heard in my entire life. There is not one unique element of personality in any singular aspect of this song. There is literally not one line in here that couldn't apply to absolutely anybody going through any type of struggle at all. At least Kelly Clarkson made her self-empowerment anthem out of worn-out cliches. Rachel's choruses made out of phrases that were too generic to become cliches in the first place. Think about that. My power's turned on, starting right now, I'll be strong? I'd feel ripped off if I got that out of a fortune cookie. This song is as much an anthem as a lump of clay is a beautiful piece of pottery. And on top of that, the song's production sounds like the Kidz Bop version of Call Me Maybe, and do I even have to say that it uses the four chord structure with no embellishments whatsoever? Like how a single word can make a heart open. The best comparison that I can think of for this song is Tonight Tonight by Hot Shell Ray, which is another bland shell of a song that does the same thing for party songs as Fight Song does for empowerment anthems. But even then, at least Hot Shell Ray had the common decency to throw some fascinatingly awful lines into the mix. And it kinda looks just like you, mixed with that Galifianakis, huh? You know that a song has hit rock bottom when it's forcing me to call Hot Shell Ray interesting. I've said before that I have far more respect for songs that try and fail over songs that don't try at all, and Fight Song is perhaps the most definitive example of this I've yet seen. Rachel Platten may have been trying to write a genuine insight into her emotional struggles, but through either talentlessness, laziness, or both, she's managed to create the most basic, overdone, and ultimately meaningless song in a genre that's defined by those qualities. However, despite my feelings towards it, I do know some people who say this song has been genuinely inspirational for them. As far as that goes, I feel the same way about this song that I do about 1-800-273-8255. If it helped you through hard times, then I don't want to diminish or belittle that, and I'm glad the song exists for your sake. However, this is my personal list, and whenever I listen to it, I hear a mind-numbingly bland, no-effort cash grab that succeeded without talent or effort, which is infuriating and offensive to me as an artist, a musician, and a critic. And if you want a demonstration of just how effective Rachel Platten's fight song really is, well... This is my And now we've got President Moonlaser. Nicely done, Rachel.
This is our fight song. Hey.
Again, I did not agree to be part of this. This song is going to irritate people.
You already know who it is.
Let's move and gay and get it on.
I remember when I was a kid, I would go down to the beach with a bucket, and I'd mix together sand and water in the bucket and pretend that I was this mystic wizard brewing up spectacular potions. I'm now at an age when I realize that sand and water don't actually form an awesome potion or really much of anything when mixed together, but I can still definitively say that there was still more chemistry going on in that bucket than there is between Charlie and Megan on this song. If you're like me and you think that this song is really annoying and cringy, but you're still in the mood for a song about when your lips are moving, please allow me to direct you to an episode of VeggieTales where Larry the Cucumber tells Archibald Asparagus about how sad he would be if his lips ever ran away from him.
If my lips ever left my mouth, packed a bag and headed south, that'd be too bad. I'd be so sad.
I see, that'd be too bad. You'd be so sad.
That'd be too bad.
Alrighty.
I forced myself to leave this one off the list because it's really not bad enough objectively, but I can't think of any song that I hate hearing on the radio more than this one. Full stop.
First let me hop out the motherfucking Porsche, I don't wanna if that ass don't see.
This is the musical equivalent of one of those demo discs that used to come with gaming magazines, except it's being sold at full price and there's a fatal error where the disc skips back to the start every 6 seconds or so.
I wanna hear you calling my name.
You're probably expecting me to tear Nikki's part to shreds, but I'm not going to do that. Like I said, I don't have an issue with a woman choosing to present herself as passive or submissive, as long as A, that's a choice she's making for herself, and B, she isn't trying to sell the idea that that's the way that things should be. Nikki's bit fills both of these requirements, so I'm gonna defend her here. Not gonna defend that synth, though.
Got the juice, your dick came the truth. My screams is the proof, some other dudes get the deuce.
Got the club going up on the Tuesday. Got your girl in the cut and she chooses.
Well, would you look at that? I was not aware that the greased up deaf guy had his own top 20 hit.
You're never gonna catch me. You're wasting your time. Forget about it. Go do something else.
I got a girl crush.
I feel like this song deserves a participation ribbon because, oh darn it, it tried so hard.
Walked in 30,000 in my pocket, had a nigga just like, ooh.
I'm kinda obligated to put this one on here because this guy literally says that he drugs women in order to get them to sleep with him and his friends. That said, I left it off the list because even when I know exactly what he's supposed to be saying, I still have trouble making it out. It's actually kind of an interesting conundrum. If a rich homie Quan advocates for date rape at the top 40 hit, but nobody hears it, is he actually advocating for date rape? Yeah.
Another, but I probably should not. I got somebody at home.
was gonna do some long, convoluted setup to try and make a country grammar pun, but this song barely cracked the top 40 of the country stations while hitting the top 10 of the general charts, so it honestly hardly even counts as a country song, despite, you know, everything about it.
Oh baby, nah baby, you got me all wrong baby.
There seemed to be quite a few songs in 2015 that people either loved or hated, the most polarizing of which being Cool for the Summer, Cake by the Ocean, and this song, Honey I'm Good. Now I personally find these songs to be awesome, noteworthy, and passable, respectively, but I can certainly see why people hate them so much, especially this one. While I hear Honey I'm Good as a song about a man who's thrilled that he loves his partner so much that he's completely fine rejecting beautiful women who are interested in him, plenty of other people see it as a song where a man is essentially bragging about what a great person he is for not cheating. Which is kind of like going around bragging that you've drowned zero kittens in your lifetime. Honestly, the details of this song do support the latter reading if you really look at them, but honestly, the song is just so upbeat and lightweight that I seriously doubt that it was intended that way, or that the majority of people took it that way. If you're one of those people who gets really angry at Honey I'm Good because you think it's about a guy painting himself out to be some sort of chivalrous hero just for not acting like a scumbag, then I have only one thing to say to you. Come on, guys. Fight the real enemy.
But I want to. And I don't want to steal your freedom. I don't want to change your mind. I don't have to make you love me. I just want to take your time.
Yep, that's right. Sam Hunt's Pothole Fetish Anthem didn't even make it onto my 2017 worst list, but his big heartfelt ballad is on the top of this one. Honestly, if you guys are still with me after the best of 1992 list, then I'm pretty sure you'll stick with me through anything at this point. I admit, Body Like a Back Road is a stupid, stupid song. But you know what? At least it's sincerely stupid. I listen to that song, and I believe that Sam Hunt does in fact believe that his significant other is sexy. The fact that he chooses to illustrate this idea by comparing her body to this is... well, that's just Sam Hunt doing what he does. However, this song, Take Your Time, is different for several reasons, the first and most obvious of which being...
I don't know if you were looking at me or not. You probably smile like that all the time. I don't mean to bother you, but I couldn't just walk by.
Now, there are many people in this world to whom the phrase Sam Hunt rapping would instantly be enough justification to send somebody to the electric chair. I am not one of those people. I don't have an issue with the speak-singing thing that Sam does on this song, or honestly any of the production. I think this song actually sounds a bit nice, if also a bit bland. Now, if you want to know why this song is on the top of this list, we're going to have to take a look at the words being said.
And I know your name, because everybody in here knows your name. You're not looking for anything right now.
The premise of this song is simple. Sam goes up to a woman at a bar, a woman who everybody knows is not looking for a hookup or anything of that sort, and Sam goes up to her and tries to hook up with her. Oh no, I misspoke. I'm sorry, that's not what's happening at all, because after all, Sam's made it clear. He's not like all those other guys she's dealt with.
And I know it starts with hello, and the next thing you know, you try to be nice, and some guy's getting too close, trying to pick you up.
Apparently, all those other guys are such a problem that this woman's even recruited a friend to help her deal with them.
And I'm sure one of your friends is about to come over here, because she's supposed to save you from random guys that talk too much and want to stay too long.
But she doesn't have to worry, because Sam isn't one of those random guys who invades her space because they don't realize that she clearly wants to be alone. Oh, no, no, no. Sam is completely aware that she doesn't want random guys invading her space, and yet he does it anyway. Because after all, he doesn't just want to take her home and hook up with her, he just wants to be her friend so that eventually she'll feel comfortable enough to hook up with him.
Could've walked away, but you're still here, and I'm still here, come on, let's see where it goes.
Look, there's no getting around it. Sam Hunt doesn't give two craps what this woman feels. It is so obvious that his endgame is to get this woman in bed, because he's not talking to her like a friend. He's talking to her like someone he wants to take home, and he's only holding back because he knows that coming on too strong would turn her off. Do these lines honestly sound like something a dude would say to a woman that he just wanted to be friends with?
your eyes are so intimidating. My heart is pounding blood, it's just a conversation.
I don't have to make you love me. I ain't gonna waste my life. I don't have to take your heart. I don't have to meet your mother. We don't have to cross that line. I don't wanna steal your covers.
Exactly. Sam clearly wrote this song trying to sound sweet and sensitive, but it actually makes him sound devious and manipulative. The only reason that Sam's not just another one of the line of drunk guys creeping on this woman is because he's not drunk yet. And so he's aware enough to realize that the only way to get into her pants is to navigate the labyrinth of her tangled emotions. Pretending to care about her feelings while really only thinking of that sweet, sweet cheese at the end of the maze. He honestly comes off even worse than the other guys, and yet he sounds so fucking proud of himself.
I don't wanna steal your freedom. I don't wanna change your mind.
I swear, when I listen to this song, the only thing that I can think of is Sam Hunt taking off his cowboy hat to reveal a fedora underneath, which he then proceeds to tip like it's never been tipped before. This song is Sam playing the exact same game he's been playing his entire career, while not only saying that he's above that game, but also saying that everybody who plays that game is a loathsome creep. In short, this song is basically the country version of Treat You Better, but somehow even worse, because at least Shawn Mendes was upfront about what he wanted. If Sam Hunt were a part of the situation painted in Treat You Better, he would be completely aware that Mendes was wrong, and he would use that self-awareness to justify to himself that he's the good guy who's much better for the girl than the guy she's already with. Oh, and on the subject of Treat You Better, I think it should be a rule of thumb that if your song is actually as sensitive and sympathetic as you think it is, you shouldn't have to make a music video where the only way that you come off looking like the good guy is by making the other guy a horrible, abusive monster straight out of a bad Lifetime movie. This song is a disgusting, manipulative piece of work from a pretentious scumbag, and the fact that there are people out there who find this song romantic and sensitive makes my skin crawl. Take Your Time by Sam Hunt, the worst hit song of 2015.
Signal.